Fantina and Will from Revelry Cycles, coming to you from a very cold and wet Sydney. Thank you for joining us today. We're really glad you're here. Today we're going to start talking about tuners. As always, we're going to put timestamps in the description so that you can know where to go to find specific information. And we're going to include a video this week that goes into engine management systems, because that's really what we're going to be talking about. It'll go a lot further into details than we're going to. We're only going to do it as far as it relates to a tuning system. So let's get into it. Okay, so you've got your exhaust, you've got your high flow air filter, you've got your cam, maybe some high compression. So what do you do now to maximize the horsepower out of those components, or how do you get the most bang for your buck? And the way that you do that is by optimizing your air fuel ratio and getting the proper ignition timing. So let's check out how we're going to fix that.
Now let's have a look at the components of the Royal Enfield fuel injection system and the basics of their functions. It starts with a fuel supply system. Inside the fuel tank, you have a fuel supply module, which is made up of a fuel pump and a pressure regulating valve. That feeds fuel out to this fuel line, which connects to the fuel rail and provides a constant supply of pressurized fuel to the fuel injectors in the throttle body. Next is the ECU. ECU stands for Electronic Control Unit, and that's exactly what it sounds like. It is electronically controlling this whole system. It controls the process. And like any other process, process has inputs, processing, and outputs. The inputs to the ECU start with the crank position. It picks up crankshaft position from this sensor inside your left-hand side cover that is just a little magnetic switch that produces an AC pulse based on these little nubs that are attached to the rotor on the end of the crankshaft. Passing it. Every time one of these passes, it sends a pulse to the ECU, and it knows where this gap is, and it uses that to determine the position of the crankshaft and the speed of the crankshaft, so it knows how fast it's turning and where the piston is in its travel. Next is the engine temperature sensor. The engine temperature sensor is this guy. It's mounted in the cylinder head, just between the cylinders. It's actually in the oil galley, so technically it's an engine oil temperature sensor, and the ECU obviously uses this to know how warm the engine is. Next is throttle position sensor, and it is exactly what it sounds like. It senses where the throttle is. So this is what it uses to determine what you're doing, what the rider's doing. This is the rider's interface to the fuel injection system. Then you've got an intake air temperature sensor that it uses, obviously, to just what it sounds like. It senses the intake air temperature and uses that to calculate air density. And then it's got the manifold MAP switch, or manifold absolute pressure switch. And that one's not so clearly defined just by its name. What this guy does is reads the manifold pressure on the inside of the throttle valve. So the valve side of the throttle valve and the throttle body, it reads variations in pressure as you open and close the throttle and increase and decrease load, climb hills, etc., etc. This is what the ECU uses to determine what kind of load the engine's under. And then you've got an oxygen sensor. This guy's in your exhaust pipe, and it tells the ECU, based on the oxygen content in the exhaust, whether the fuel mixture is too rich or too lean, and the ECU adjusts accordingly when it's in closed loop mode. So it takes all those inputs. It does calculations based on a three-dimensional map. It knows engine RPM, it knows throttle position, and it also knows load. So based on what requirements the rider is asking of the motorcycle at any given time, it calculates what the air-fuel ratio should be and when the spark should occur, and it outputs an injector pulse. So it tells the injectors when to fire and how long to stay open. So it pulses the injector at the right time, and the longer it stays open, the more fuel gets delivered, and that's called pulse width. It also controls the ignition timing and provides very precise spark timing based on all of those variables.
What's the purpose of a tuner? Simply put, a tuner allows precise adjustments to the air-fuel ratio. On a stock motorcycle, they aim for what's called a stoichiometric ratio. Stoichiometric simply means that it's going to burn as efficiently as possible all the fuel during the combustion process and have the least amount of emissions. A stoichiometric ratio on a petrol-powered engine is 14.7 to 1. That's 14.7 parts of air to one part of fuel. On a performance engine, 14.7 to 1 works fine for startup, idling, or while cruising. But if you want the best throttle response, and if you want it to pull during acceleration, then the goal is a ratio closer to 12 to 13.5 to 1, which basically means we're enriching the mixture. And the only way to achieve this on a fuel-injected motorcycle is with a tuner. So all tuners adjust the air-fuel ratio, but only some of them will adjust ignition timing. If you're adding a cam, boosting your compression, or running different fuels, you may benefit from, but you may also need to be able to adjust your timing.
Then the question is always, do I need a tuner? When do I need a tuner? Well, the reality is that even with really mild modifications, air cleaner and exhaust, you can benefit from a tuner. You can smooth out and get improved throttle response and pull some more horsepower out. Just adding fuel does make a difference. But the real answer to when do I need a tuner is when you make changes to things that drastically affect volumetric efficiency in the combustion chamber. Things like cams and higher flow cylinder heads, throttle bodies, bigger bore, all of those. When you've increased displacement, that all changes the equation, and now you need a tuner. The other question we get all the time is, won't my stock ECU just learn or adapt to these modifications? And the truth is, to a point, it absolutely will. Certainly, air cleaners, mufflers, that sort of thing, you can bolt those on your bike, start it up, go ride it. It will absolutely adapt to that. It's perfectly safe to ride. Won't hurt a thing in the world. It'll run just fine. In fact, it'll run better with those modifications in the stock ECU than it did before. But the thing you have to remember about the stock ECU is that it is always trying to pull the fuel ratio back to 14.7 to 1. And that's all you're ever going to get, right? And that's not where the power is. Every motorcycle is different, and depending on what it's being used for and a million variables, the fuel ratio requirements will be different, but the real power is always in that 12 to 13.5 to 1 air-fuel ratio. And if you're going to make all the power that's possible, you have to be able to tune precisely.
So, what are your options? The first one I want to tell you about is one that I'm asked about all the time, but I've never actually fitted, so I don't have an example here for you, and that's the booster plug. Now, the booster plug is sort of elegant in its simplicity, in that all it does is allow the air-fuel ratio to be enriched. It does this by feeding the ECU false information. It tells the ECU that the air coming in is actually colder than it is, and then the ECU thinks that the air is more dense and adds fuel to the mixture. So it's kind of brilliant, but it's imprecise and it's pretty limited for the sort of things that we do, so we just haven't fit one before. Your next option is the Power Commander 5 by Dynojet. Now, this tuner is air fuel ratio only. It does not do ignition timing. The next one is the Powertronic. Now, Powertronic does air fuel. It also does ignition timing. This is one that we probably fit most often. Both the Power Commander and the Powertronic have the option of a map switch. So this lets you have two maps downloaded to the motorcycle, one power, one economy, that you can just switch between with a simple switch on the handlebars. They also have the option for a quick shifter, and Will fit one of these to Scram, and he loves riding with it. Now, the last one I'm gonna mention is this S&S programmable ECU. This is not for the novice tuner. This is a blank ECU that is fully programmable. This will require that you can splice it into your ignition, into your stock wiring harness. The best thing to do is actually build a wiring harness, which is what we'll be doing when we install this in our 965.
So then the question is always, what can I reasonably expect from a tuner? Well, the reality is, if you've got a bike with air cleaner, mufflers, headers, maybe even a cam, that kind of level of modification with and without a tuner, you can expect something like 8 to 10% more horsepower and torque with a tuner. And that's cool, that's good, but what you really feel, the difference, the thing that you really feel in the real world with a tuner is the throttle response. Yeah, the properly tuned bike responds to the throttle much more quickly and aggressively than without a tuner.
It's a smile factor.
It is a smile factor.
It's a big smile factor.
Yeah.
So, please join us next week. We're going to get a little bit more in depth in fitting a tuner, and we're going to share some dyno charts with a motorcycle that has some performance components fit to it that we've tuned, and then without the tune, so that you can see what the actual difference is. Until then, please like, share, comment, ring the bell. I want to say, I have gotten messages this week from Brazil, Ireland, the US, all over. So in the comments below, let us know where you are in the world. It's definitely let us know that it is a universal truth that if you ain't having fun,
you're doing it wrong.